And the contactors obviously are here. Generally, they're placed close to the battery in a module called a battery disconnect unit. There's often one set of contactors on both the high and low lines coming from the charging port, and another set of contactors between the battery and the inverter. So most standard EVs would have about four contactors per vehicle.
Okay. Hi, I'm Joel Franke with Charged Magazine, and I'm here at APEC this week, and I'm talking with Matt Reynolds from TDK, and we're going to talk about
our high voltage DC contactors.
Okay.
For mainly for automotive, but they're also industrial applications for energy storage and renewable energy.
Okay.
But this display is all dedicated to automotive EV, mainly EV applications. For all of our components and the high voltage DC contactors are an important part of that system. They provide the battery disconnect between the batteries and either the inverter of the car or to the DC fast charger that's plugged into the car.
Okay.
So it's a safety device to provide a disconnect.
So TDK did a session in our virtual conference last week, and there were some really good questions from the audience. So you cool with asking a few of those?
Absolutely.
Okay. I had to write them down. Can't remember them all. Okay. So one of the audience members asked, is a lower contact resistance better?
Simple answer, yes.
Okay.
The contact resistance is the resistance between the contact bridge, between the two main contacts on the top of the contactor. And so there's two points of contact, and the full current that goes through the contactor could be up to 500 amps, passes through this contact resistance and generates heat. And so the important point is that we don't want the contactor heating up beyond a certain limit, and that's what's determining the current rating, the continuous current rating of the contactors, is because of the amount of heating that occurs by passing the current through this contact resistance. One of the other important points about contact resistance is this will change a bit over the life of the contact. What we see initially, contact resistance will go down a little bit early in life, and then towards end of life, it'll start to go up again. And this is because if you have a lot of braking events where you're braking full current, the arcing that you get during that process can create over a number of cycles some damage on the surface of the okay. of the copper contact. So the contact resistance will increase a little bit.
Okay. We got about five more. Okay.
All right. Absolutely.
How is the HVC sealed, and why is this important?
Okay. So TDK has just one style of a switching chamber. It's a ceramic switching chamber, and that's sealed. There's metal components on the top and bottom, and we do a brazing connection between. So it's a metal brazing between the metal components and the ceramic chamber. And this provides a hermetic seal. So it's completely hermetically sealed. And this is important because we fill the chamber with a mix of gases. And these gases are able to help quench and cool the arc that forms when you're braking,
okay.
braking the full current. And this is a similar technology that we have from our gas discharge tubes. It's a protection device. So TDK has been producing gas discharge tubes for about 80 years, and it's much the same technology, only much smaller. It's mm-hmm. a ceramic sleeve. It's got a brazing connection to the two electrodes.
Okay.
So that's the bridge from our older product to this new product, is the technology and the know-how that we have to process this chamber. There is another type of chamber that's a resin sealed chamber. We don't produce any product like that. We feel that you get a much better lifetime and higher reliability with a ceramic switching chamber because of this hermetic sealing.
All right.
That contains the gases and they can't leak out.
Okay. All right. I see that TDK offers a dual coil for the contactor. What are the advantages of using a dual versus a single?
Okay, so yeah, the coil is the solenoid coil which operates the relay, the contactor. And if you have just one single coil, then it's always the same amount of power. But it turns out that it's beneficial if you can have a higher amount of power initially to make the closure. It makes a fast closure and a secure connection once it's closed. And then once it's closed, you can live with a much lower amount of power to maintain it closed.
Okay.
So the dual coil allows you to have a higher power level initially to make a good closing, and then
so is that
a lower
like the
power
force on the contactor.
It helps a higher force on the contactor to close it securely and make a good connection. And then that coil gets switched out automatically after a short period of time, and then a lower power can be used to maintain it. So then I think the specifications are for single coils about 6 watts or 6 to 8 watts. The dual coil has only 4 watts for holding.
So you
have a reduction of the power the whole time that it's closed that's required.
Okay. How does PWM compare to dual coil as a form of reducing coil power consumption? You kind of just covered that.
A little bit. Instead of using two coils, there's one single coil and you have a separate pulse width modulation circuit that can modify the amount of power applied to the coil. So then you can have this high power initially and the lower power later. But there are some other tricky points with PWM. First of all, you have the extra cost of this added circuitry. But also because it's pulse width modulation, there's high frequency switching of the power, and this can generate some noise and EMI that could potentially cause problems with other nearby circuitry.
Okay.
So it's very flexible, but it can generate some other issues. And the dual coil doesn't have any pulse width modulation, so a very clean EMI signature then.
Okay. It's solving a few problems, it sounds like.
Yeah.
So what is the lifetime of the gas inside the contactor? And do you have vacuum solutions instead of filling them with gas?
Right. So we have a proprietary mixture of gases that go into the chamber. And this is also part of the know-how that we're bringing from our gas discharge tubes. We're using similar gas mixtures in those as well, with the main goal being that they help to quench the arc and cool the arc as quickly as possible. The lifetime of the gas is it's not an issue, especially with the hermetically sealed gas chamber. The gases don't break down. They're, you know, mostly hydrogen, and there's some other noble gases that are very stable, so they don't break down chemically.
Okay.
The main goal is to make sure that you just have a very good seal and you don't lose the gas over the lifetime. So as long as you're observing all the other specifications with regard to maximum current and make and break cycles and these kinds of things, there's no issue with the gas escaping or breaking down chemically or anything like that.
Okay, all right. We are down to the last question. All right, when a high voltage contactor has a rated current of, let's say, 500 amps, mm-hmm. what does that mean?
Yeah, so 500 amps is determined by some operating conditions. We usually specify a certain cross section of bus bar that's mm-hmm. attached to the terminals here. So you need a certain amount of cross section of copper that helps to keep everything cool. And then this is also normally tested in a ambient environment with no, you know, just natural convection, no cooling, flowing air, anything like that. So it's the temperature rise that occurs at the terminal that determines the maximum steady state current.
Okay.
So basically, when you're at that full rated current, you're achieving our limit temperature at the terminal, which is generally 130 degrees C. It's a little bit of safety guard band there, but the terminals reach 130 degrees C, and under a steady state condition, that should be 500 amps for a 500 amp rated contactor. Now, what's also not immediately apparent, it is specified on our data sheet, is you're allowed to have much higher currents for shorter periods of time because it's a question of heating up everything in that system. So you can have even double or more the current for very short periods of time, for seconds or even milliseconds, very high current, because it's just a question of heating it up, which takes some time. Mm-hmm. So generally there are some different currents and times that are specified on the data sheet that are also allowed to have, you know, short-term higher levels of current. This is important inside an EV because as you're accelerating, you're going to have a higher level of current, but you're not spending a lot of time accelerating. Once you get up to speed, then you slow down and the current can come back down again.
Sure.
So this is determined by the drive cycle of the vehicle, and most vehicle manufacturers pay close attention to how much time they can spend at higher currents, and mm-hmm. and this is really a cost driver for contactors, because you know more current generally requires more copper.
Sure.
And that adds to the cost. So they're what's important to right size the specification for the application.
Okay. Well, that covers the questions. Is there anything else you wanted to let the audience know about?
Yeah, well, I mean, maybe we can just, I can back up a little bit and we can show the whole display here.
Okay.
TDK's got a wide variety of products that we can offer for EV applications, for traction inverters, for OBC, for DC to DC. And the contactors obviously are here. Generally, they're placed close to the battery in a module called a battery disconnect unit. And there's often one set of contactors on both the high and low lines coming from the charging port, and another set of contactors between the battery and the inverter. So most standard EVs would have about four contactors per vehicle.
Okay.
There are some reasons that they might have more or less depending on the design, but that's the basic application for the use of high voltage contactors in EV. But there are also industrial applications. And if you think about it, an EV is basically an energy storage system on wheels.
Yeah.
There are other energy storage systems that people are installing for their homes for backup power. It's also a big battery bank, and there would be high voltage contactors for something like that as well.
Okay.
So those are the main applications.
Thanks, Matt.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Nice talking to you.
And for all of you at home, we will put a link in the description so you can visit TDK's website and find out more on your own. Thank you.